to see mass. Right.
Janaji, during mass communication, we often treat mass as a target audience, to whom we are writing, to whom we are presenting our news bulletins. If I am a television channel, then my mass will be the people who are watching, the people who are consuming the news. People made from America, people made from Australia, people made from India, Sri Lanka. There is no limitation when it comes to geographical phenomena of mass, when it comes to journalism.
Mm-hmm. If by very nature, we take mass as a diversified community with cultural differences and regional variations, who would be the reader?
Commanding sources?
Who would be the reader? Thinks mass belongs to others, not to others. Is there anyone who thinks that I am part of mass? It's a very abstract notion actually. See, the definition you gave is so large, it's very difficult to identify somebody as mass.
No, we can. Mass can be somebody. When it comes to somebody, then we can say an individual.
We have a tendency to otherize the mass.
One of the first usages was after the First World War, actually beginning of the First World War. All those sections were expropriated by the capitalist system, where factories thrown out a lot of people, agriculture thrown out a lot of people, world wars thrown out a lot of people, out of the systems. Those who went out of the system are seen as mass. That was one of the media, perfectly. See, what you said is a functional definition. All those people who doesn't fit into any system, agriculture for instance now, modernization of agriculture throws out a lot of people outside the system. Everybody who is part of some system are not part of mass. For every word there will be the evaluation, the history of evolution of the world. Not the first time it was used for those people who were migrating from one country to another country in sense of labor, physical labor. And people who are moved by colonial powers from one country to another country, for them they use the word mass. These are very, very, for instance, all serious thinking is about differentiating between one word to another word. For instance, you will be surprised to know, almost for 3 years, Indian Constituent Assembly debated about future India. Okay? How many years? 3 years. You hardly find a word called a citizen in the whole debate for 3 years. You don't find the word used very often, citizen.
Citizen.
They use the word people.
Why so? Why so?
Because people are different from citizens.
Which are they?
Legalized people is citizen.
People are not legal.
People are people. They are also people. Citizen are from.
See, now we use word. If now we use word citizen more than people, because we have 70 years of governance. You are governed by some 3,500 laws. There is a law, therefore you are sitting here. If you go out on the road, there is a law which governs you. If you drive a vehicle, there is a law which governs you. You understand? So people are different from citizens. All people are not citizens. All citizens are not. Okay? And masses are again different from these two words.
Can you say that deprived, suppressed, and marginalized in the society, those who are not part of any system, can be termed as mass?
At least that is the beginning of the world, meaning of the word, masses. For a reader, you have to give some imagination of the people to whom you are writing. You are saying now below 30 years, therefore, Facebook or multimedia, whatever. But going by the kind of digitization that is happening now, after 50 years, who will you consider as age group? For Facebook. Will you say then also below 30 years? This is your convenience. After 50 years, all 100% people, let us suppose that you have Facebook. Then you will not say that I am targeting this people. This is a very arbitrary functional definition of the word mass. Okay, let us. Which differs from time to time. I am only pointing out when was the this word was commonly used to denote to understand what kind of phenomena they use with the word. Okay, that's one thing.
It's historical.
Okay. Now we have different meaning. Even now also, when we are saying that, when you are using mass media, you have one meaning. But otherwise, mass, the word has a lot of meaning. For instance, even for the word people, what do we understand when we say people? As a collective, we think we understand the word people. Okay, now when we talk about power, let us go from very simple issues. In conventional sense, what do we understand power?
The ability of someone or some group. The ability of someone or some group to influence someone else or some other group.
That's one of the dimensions of power. Okay. Any other? No, in the popular sense, political sense, what do we call the power?
Authority, superiority over someone else.
No.
Authority
of
influencing.
Okay. No, I'm saying in political sense, not in the deeper sense.
Means to govern.
Through elections, now people elect somebody. So, who exercises the power?
People.
Generally, we have all the change that, you know, it's like there should be checks and balances, therefore, three organs are there. Legislature makes the law, executive implements it.
Judiciary.
What is it to be?
That is implemented. It is the supreme power that resolves.
It
keeps a check on the legislator and the executive.
It safeguards the law.
What is the standard it uses? What is the standard it uses to assess whether the law or power exercised by executive as well as legislature, whether that is right or wrong, to say that it is right or wrong, it has to use some standard. No? What is the standard it uses?
It uses law.
Which law? To assess the law, also it has to use the standard. No? What is that law?
Yeah.
Constitution. Okay. So what is constitution then? Mother of all laws?
Constitution, if a very good, it defines how a man should function.
Mother of all laws.
Yeah, Constitution is mother of all laws. And how Constitution is made?
From the experience, from the culture. Yeah. It is supposed to be
history. History, culture. So, this debate, see, these three organs are supposed to function, but how does it function actually as layers of power? See, I just explained. There is one article in the Constitution called Untouchability is Prohibited. Okay? Section 17. Then how we are implementing it? Then what it will do?
The executives was executive see in the ground that the article of the constitution or constitution's article was properly functioning over the
okay.
If any disturbance happened, then judiciary comes back and they do their work and do their regular job. Make things regular.
Okay, let us not speculate, I'll tell you.
Yeah.
Now, say, to implement that untouchability is prohibited, they made an act in 1955. This is called the Untouchability Prohibition Act. Okay. Now, this act, what does it, this Article 17 represent in the Constitution? Why untouchability was to be prohibited? Why it has to be prohibited?
Constitution itself says that
every
citizen is all equal.
The Constitution was meant to say this.
Yeah.
Constitution doesn't say.
Yeah.
Constitution was meant to say. But why you thought it should be there in the Constitution?
Because there was a lot of class difference before the Constitution.
Okay. So, about untouchability, any one figure that who spoke a lot?
B.R. Ambedkar.
Untouchability, I'm asking.
Untouchability. B.R. Ambedkar.
Gandhi.
Even
Mahatma Gandhi. There is another difference. That's why I'm asking.
Ambedkar.
Okay. And that there will be this one sentence that untouchability is same. And then below that there will be Gandhi. Okay. Is that what Ambedkar spoke? See, in the name of Gandhi there will be one sentence.
And that you need to be said.
Same. But is that what Ambedkar spoke? Mm-hmm. Then what?
He spoke in favor of progressive lower class, as if the lower class should not be counted as inhumans. They should also have been given equal opportunities.
See, you said equality, you said
equal
opportunities, and there is a word undisability. That word doesn't have anything to do with these two things.
No, you asked why is there untouchability, why was it involved in the constitution? So we are just speculating the chances that it was in the constitution because everybody should be considered equal. And if you are considering one person as untouchability, as untouchable, then you are not counting them as an equal.
Whatever you are speculating is the experience of thinking about this act in the past 70 years. Okay? But they do not speculate this. This act was made. And then 1976, they changed, amended, reformulated as Protection of Civil Rights Act. Okay? All those issues that are there around the question of untouchability. See, untouchability sounds like it's a physical problem. Okay? It's a physical, whether you touch somebody or not. Okay? They thought, no, it's not. It is a question of civil rights. Okay? So therefore they made an act called Protection of Civil Rights Act. Now, it was made in 1976. And in that they said, you can't stop somebody from going to taking water from well. You can't make some student go no, not to sit in the class. So that kind of things, they made some 10-15 sections. And then, by 1989, they thought this Protection of Civil Rights Act is not solving the problem. Then they made an act called Scheduled Castes, Scheduled Tribes, Protection of the Prevention of Atrocities Act. Okay. Now, this act, again now I amended in 2015. Now, this act identified something like 100 forms of caste discrimination. How many? Yeah. So we began with one form of discrimination called undisability. Okay. Now, how did we understand this 100 forms of discrimination? I am not interested in particular forms. How did they write this?